Previously on Up at Noon.
With the all-new Wii U, this is how you will play next.
Nintendo, you psychopath!
The all-new Wii U. How you will play next.
What's up, everybody? I'm Greg Miller. Welcome to Up at Noon. Please give it up for the Wii U. As usual, if you enjoy Up at Noon, please subscribe, like the video, and leave a comment below. If you don't like the show, like it all the same. It really teaches us a lesson. Double plus good show this week. Mike Drucker gives us a review of Call of Duty Black Ops 2 based solely on the title. Then I sit down with Jeremiah Slaczka to talk about the new Scribblenauts Unlimited. And then I talk to Harold Ryan from Bungie about the 10th anniversary of Xbox Live. That's right! Two interviews. But before all that, the news you care about. Attention, Matt Morkinson. Turn off the cover sheets on your IGN printouts. You're killing everything. Magic the Gathering publisher Wizards of the Coast is being sued for patent infringement over the use of electronic trading cards. While it's still early, the judge in the case has made the decision that both parties are nerds.
Ogre.
Super Mario creator Shigeru Miyamoto has said that he's visiting third-party video game studios to convince them to develop for the Wii U, which has to be the world's most awkward moment for game designers. Oh my god, Shigeru Miyamoto is my hero! He wants you to develop for the Wii U. Tell him I'm not here! A charity in South Africa is offering a free cell phone to anyone who brings in 60 dead rats. The grossest part of that story? It's a flip phone. It's from Verizon, too. The Wii U comes out on Sunday. Who here's excited?
Yeah, woo! 4 more years!
According to a new study, the nearer you live to a bar, the more likely you are to drink. You can read more about it in this month's issue of Brian Altano Magazine. Sega has announced that their revenue dropped by a third this year. Even worse, it made this sound. Even worse than that, this is the sound playing in their offices. Dark days. The Disney Channel is developing a sequel to Boy Meets World. The new show will be titled Adult Watching Daytime Television Meets Loneliness. A Castle Wolfenstein movie is in the works. While producers say it's going to be just like the game, I find it hard to believe when the subtitle is Anne Frank's Revenge. It's enough time has passed. It's okay. Bethesda has announced new DLC for the Xbox 360 version of Skyrim that lets players fly on the backs of dragons and explore new regions. It's called Skyrim, you, PlayStation. And finally, the hotly anticipated Call of Duty Black Ops 2 comes out tomorrow. Here with his review based solely on the title is Mike Drucker.
Hey guys, yeah. Let me tell you all about Call of Duty Black Ops 2. You play as Eddie Murphy as police officer Axel Foley as he cleans up the mean streets of Beverly Hills. Multiplayer includes putting bananas in the tailpipes.
Okay, I see what's happening here.
Even the tutorial is fun, with Denzel Washington as the guy from Training Day teaching you the ropes. Careful of that PCP! Nobody made you smoke it! You gotta live with your decisions! These streets are mean!
Drucker, you're getting the title wrong.
Kill the predator monster as Danny Glover, and then learn to laugh again with Carl Winslow and his sidekick Urkel. Did I do that? Only if that is cracking the case wide open.
Wait, Drucker.
But it's not all fun in games. You need to hunt down the 7 serial killer as Morgan Freeman. And half of the cast of Law & Order is DLC. I love you, Anthony Anderson.
Drucker.
Don't worry, I'll give it a score. 11.10 out of 10. IGN.
No, Drucker, you don't understand. The game is called Call of Duty Black Ops 2.
Right, Call of Duty Black Ops 2.
No. Call of Duty Black space Ops space 2.
Oh no.
You already pre-ordered the special edition, didn't you?
Yeah, I did.
Because you love black cops.
Uh-huh.
All right, what if I told you it takes place in a post-apocalyptic, hyper-technological future with zombies?
Do black cops arrest those zombies?
I'm afraid not, buddy.
Hello, GameStop? Cancel my pre-order. Put it all on Need for Speed Most Haunted.
Okay, that's not a game either.
What? Ugh. Okay, put it on the game where you assassinate all the band members in Creed.
Still not a game. Mike Drucker, everybody. I do kind of want the game you described, though. Speaking of games I want, Gregway, our first guest this week has a game I really want. Everybody, please give it up for Scribblenauts Unlimited, Jeremiah Slaczka. As I live and breathe,
Jeremiah Slaczka, how are you?
Good.
Thank you for coming here.
Yes.
Scribblenauts. This franchise has been going on a while now.
Yeah, since 2009, actually.
At what point did you figure out it wasn't going to be a giant disaster? Because it sounds like when you talk about this game, mm-hmm. you're like, oh, you're going to be able to write words in. And you're like, oh, man, gamers love writing words in and being addiction. And I remember I was lucky enough to be at that E3 where you guys debuted, and it was one of those things, one person came back and they were like, everybody needs to play Scribblenauts.
Right.
We're like, what the hell is Scribblenauts?
Yeah, yeah.
And then we went over and played it and it turned out it was awesome.
It exploded, yeah. Actually, when I pitched it internally in late 2008, nobody wanted to do it. All the programmers are like, you're crazy and I don't want to do this.
Yeah.
but then our tech director, I basically was like, he's like, no, I understand how we can do this. Like, we're going to make this whole system where you know, it's kind of hierarchical where you're like, there's you know, animals and then people, and they'll have AI and they'll have, you know, like what can burn and what can't and stuff like that. And so, you know, we can actually have 25, 50,000, 100,000 words and it'll actually work without having the people be like, okay, tree burns, you know, furniture burns. Like, it's like, you know, we can actually make it so it was manageable for the designers and stuff.
So
like
you had to like group things
together.
Yeah,
it was all very grouped. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. And so, once you figured that out, was it easy to sell everybody on, or was it still an uphill battle?
No, it's still an uphill battle, especially for publishers. Like, we pitched it around a lot of people, and Warner Brothers, they picked it up, but a lot of people were like, I don't believe you can finish this off, like, you know? And we actually debuted with IGN. We actually debuted Scribblenauts at the very, very beginning. We showed it off, and people were like, yeah, this is just a video. Like, you just made a Flash video or something like that. No, it really worked. And so, Warner Brothers kind of picked it up and they really kind of got it. And then at E3, it literally exploded. It exploded. And it was the first handheld game ever in the history of E3 to win Game of Show from IGN, GameSpot, GameSpy. So that was incredible. We didn't even know anything was going to happen like that. But I think people just kind of, you know, they kind of glom onto the ability that it's all about your imagination and you can really do whatever you want. And so the game's always kind of been about that. People talk about how, you know, it's like, oh, it's a writing game or it's a puzzle game. No. It's a game about imagination. Mm-hmm. That's what it's really about.
So then, for it being imagination, you have hundreds of thousands of words in the game. How do you keep that franchise going then? How do you keep iterating on it?
So we started out with nouns, right? And obviously not proper nouns, but nouns. And then we went to adjectives, right? That was kind of the next thing that we wanted to do. And then for this one, for the Wii U, 3DS and PC, that's coming out this year.
Scribblenauts Unlimited.
The reason why it's called Unlimited is because you can actually create your own objects. So again, people are like, oh, well, you know, after nouns and adjectives, of course, adverbs, right?
Yeah,
like,
course.
Yeah, very, very large thing, you know, like, no. And
like, we're not giving away education for free, all right? Still got to go to school.
Yeah, and so the reason why we wanted to do that with creating objects is because, again, it's not about writing, it's about the imagination. The writing is just like the input method, right? Mm-hmm. It's the best input method to be able to spawn anything you can think of, right? But it's about your imagination and about just being very, very creative. And so that's why Unlimited, you can actually create your own objects and share them online with other people. And you can create anything. Like, that's why it's Unlimited.
Yeah. How are you going to be able to police what people are putting up there? You don't want the bad kids putting up the bad things.
It's true. That's why we don't have to worry about that, because Nintendo and WB are going to be doing that.
Oh, great. So. Okay. Well, there you go. More concrete online information about the Wii U. one of the big parts, though, is that, you know, it's this Wii U game. You're putting some of the Nintendo guys in there.
Yes,
who's showing up?
Yeah, we got the Mario franchise and Zelda franchise. We got a little kind of lot of Easter eggs, like with Zelda or with the Zelda IP. You can write Link, and you can write Ocarina, and then he'll play opponent's song, and then opponent will come ride opponent, stuff like that. So Mario will actually jump on Goombas and destroy them, and you know, like, he'll use a Super Mushroom, and that'll make him big. Go fight Bowser. Bowser like spits fireballs. You know, just even little stuff like we had like Peach, and if you give her a parasol, she'll float around and stuff like that. So stuff the fans like. We got even some obscure guys like Tingle, and the Goron and stuff like that. So we got our Gorons. So yeah, no, it's kind of a big thing. It's as far as I know, could be wrong, so hopefully I'm not wrong.
Nah, you're sorry.
But I think we're the second Western game ever to have Nintendo IP in it. The first being NBA Street, which of course makes perfect sense.
Yeah, of course, yeah. Such hallowed halls that yes. Nintendo has graced.
So yeah, and so I guess we're the second one ever. I mean, there's definitely been Japanese IP that they've worked with, but never Western. So we feel very humbled that Nintendo is like, yeah, this is totally cool. So yeah, Miyamoto actually had to, you know, he actually looked at it and approved it and said, no, I'm down with this and stuff. So again, very cool. You know, obviously as a game designer, almost all game designers are, you know, just awestruck by what Miyamoto did for their childhood.
Yeah.
So to have him be like, yeah, no, Maxwell and Mario, that's awesome. I'm like, yeah, you know.
Yeah. In that now, they're not the only ones making cameos, correct? Some more WB properties are coming over.
Incorrect, actually.
Nope. All right.
And here's why.
Thanks, Rich George.
So here's why. Here's why you think that. So on our official Scribblenauts Facebook page, we talked about, we showed pictures of Scooby-Doo, Batman, and Mortal Kombat. Yeah. Those are all user created.
Oh wow! Okay.
So that's how strong the editor is that you couldn't even tell that they weren't made by us.
Well, Rich George couldn't tell. He's an idiot.
And I know a lot of fans too. They didn't realize that. So no, it's really really cool. It's like I said, our object editor is so powerful. It's almost the exact same tool that we use in-house to make the game itself.
So are you then bringing the creations into the puzzle? Am I as a user downloading other users and then bringing them into the puzzles you guys have created?
You can, yeah, you okay. can. Again, the puzzles, you know, Scribblenauts is very open-ended, right?
Yeah.
So some things aren't going to work for some certain circumstances, but yeah, if you want to, that's kind of the thing. And also, we have multiplayer now on the Wii U specifically and only. So player one, he has the gamepad, right? And so he can still type stuff, he or she can still type stuff. And the other players have used the Wiimotes, and they can just possess anything you type and then play as that thing. So if they want to be, somebody was actually a gun just recently, and they basically shot everything up, like floating gun, and so it becomes AI and stuff like that. You can be anything. It's Scribblenauts. I mean, that's the fun
yeah,
thing.
Yeah,
right?
That's
so you can
point.
Literally do anything you want. So you can also, those user-created objects, you can possess and play as those, and whatever characteristics and attributes people made for that, you can play as that.
You want to say anything else to the crowd here? You want to try to get the Wii U in their hands, the Scribblenauts? What do you want to say?
Yeah, I mean,
this is your moment.
This is my moment. Wow. Okay. So you know, it's the next Scribblenauts. We call it Scribblenauts Unlimited because it's the kind of ultimate version of Scribblenauts. So far, you can write anything you want. You can create anything you want now. All new HD art, which is really really awesome, and you can share it with friends. And also, you get to see Maxwell's story for the very first time. He has 42 brothers and sisters. Well, 41 brothers, one sister.
Wow. Yeah. Mom's a whore.
No.
Ladies and gentlemen, we enjoy talking to people so much, we're going to do it twice in the same show. Put your hands together one more time for Harold Ryan from Bungie. As I live and breathe, Harold Ryan, how are you?
Great. Thanks for having me.
I'm honored to have you. I'm blown away we could get you. Bungie just shipped Halo 4. Here you are, ready to get right to it.
And you know, it was the easiest ship we ever had.
I'm sure it was. The least stress for a Halo game you've ever had.
There's a couple hundred people still at Microsoft. That was their game.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. I got that wrong.
Yeah.
Obviously, elephant in the room. Have you played Halo 4?
I've played Halo 4.
What'd you think?
It's very beautiful to look at. There's a lot of Halo in the game. Okay. I think it was fun to play.
All right, good. So they did okay by you?
Yeah.
Okay. I think they did. You're not going to stab anybody?
No.
3-4. David Ellis can walk the streets okay.
He can walk the streets okay, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, we're here to talk about your new game.
Yeah, new game.
What's it all about?
It's going to be awesome.
Yeah?
Shipping sometime.
No, of course, you are not talking at all about your next game. That's okay. We're going to talk about some history today. Xbox Live, 10 years old.
10 years. 10 years since the console went online. People could get together, play.
Does that make you feel old?
Yeah, it does.
It snuck up on us here.
Because
you know,
these
kids in the audience, they can't remember a time when they weren't playing games online
no.
with their Wikipedia phones.
Yeah, connect everything everywhere you go.
Exactly, you're getting beamed down through, you got LED technology, I don't know.
Don't even know how to carry a TV from one house to another.
No, they'll never understand LAN parties again. Take me back, I guess, more like 11 to 12 years ago.
Yeah.
You guys have made Halo.
Yeah.
You're working on Halo 2.
Sure.
Somebody shows up again eventually and I'm like, they're like, hey, you know, have you heard of this internet?
Yeah, this internet thing. Well, it was crazy. Halo 1, you know, we're like, hey, you could play on a network together. It's going to be cool. And then we almost cut it because it didn't work.
Yeah.
And but it worked at the last minute and started hearing stories. People were modding submarines, getting in trouble in the military and hooking their bunks up, networking to play the game. LAN parties started happening. And then the guys on the live team were like, we should start connecting Xboxes. And we're like, our game doesn't work like that. We need a whole bunch of code, a lot of smart people. And yeah, so we started.
Was like, sure, here you go.
Yeah.
The code, here's the smart people.
Well, we did okay with the first game. A few people bought it.
I think so, Halo, yeah, Combat Evolved, I've heard of it.
They were willing to invest a little bit. And you know, the Xbox was doing well. Live was a good initiative for Microsoft. And so they really went for it. And it was it took a lot of work, but it was cool.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah, were you hesitant to be part of it, to get it going? I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, it was 10 years for Live, years for Live, and then you guys were a little bit after even the launch of Live.
Yeah, so they launched the first version of Live 2 years before we launched with an updated version of it with Halo 2.
Okay.
And so we basically, once Live went out, we started looking at it, working on internal builds, and build a whole debugging system. They put a giant team together to work with us. And we really set out to push the limits. Did launch social gaming, really, with groups and clans built, hooked up to BungieNet in the game so you could join with your friends, matchmake with them. It was a big deal for us.
See, it was a big deal, I think, for the industry, right? I don't think anybody can look past that as how important it is that you had groups, you had BungieNet, you had this interconnected system on not something that was fledgling, but definitely something that was brand new.
Yeah.
How were you able to do that, create something that was like pretty much the pinnacle for a long time? I mean, it was the most played online Xbox Live game till what, Gears of War, the original, correct? I mean, like...
Yeah, it was a couple years after Halo 2 that it finally dropped out of the top spot. Yeah. But it was, we built a huge infrastructure, back-end debugging. We had this system where we could collect about a terabyte of data. I guess all the fans can look up that. They know what that is. Kids are smart these days.
They're on the YouTube right now. YouTube, they can open a new incognito tab.
But we were set up so that you could go, everyone who played Halo 2 before we shipped it, we uploaded all their information as they were playing, what was happening with their networks. Tons of bugs to fix, you know, when no one in Germany can play the game and you're sitting in Bellevue trying to figure out why it's not working in Germany. It was a big effort, but we were lucky. We had a lot of smart guys on our team, a lot of smart guys on the Live team, and really pushed the limit.
Did you learn a lot of lessons with the first time you were on when you were doing Halo 2? I know there was always talk about, you know, single player campaigns on a cliffhanger because of this, that, and the other.
Yep.
Did you learn how to manage resources, stuff like that?
Yeah, I mean, I think as you look at a game, you know, once you build it and you build an online game and you have to keep feeding it new maps and keep managing the community, the nice thing is that's historically what Bungie's always done. Myth and Marathon had online communities that a Bungie game is a game you ship, you love, and you feed it, you maintain it, interact with the fans, and grow the game over time. And so doing that with the Halo games was a natural extension of what we do.
All right, put on your thinking caps. Let's look into the future. What's going on with video games? Are we going to continue? Like, we talk all the time on the show, you know, that there's either going to be these AAA games, like the stuff you're making, or there's got to be downloadable games, right? It seems like that middle tier is dropping out, and we're getting down to this point. Is that alarming to you? I mean, when you look at these other young indie developers, upstarts trying to get their way in the world.
Yeah, and it's crazy to see the number of small developers. You know, you go ask a guy like Chris Taylor, who's a great designer. He's done lots of great games over time. And you know, he and I have talked a bunch in the past about describing the sort of fight of being in that middle. You're either all the way up here on, you know, big $100 million games, or you're over here trying to do it for $50,000. And the guys in the middle get beat around. Once in a while they succeed, but more often than not they're losing money, and they have, most of them, dropped out of the market. It's sort of disappointing to see that avenue for games, the creativity, not be there in the world.
What is your take then on where a lot of those middle people are starting to go to, like, you know, where they're going to go do iOS games, they're going to go do some browser stuff?
Yeah, I mean, what I hope and what's happening, it's getting easier to get your game out there. Kickstarter, I think, is a great thing for if someone comes up with a cool creative idea, can get funded and get to a point where if it really needs publishing resources or big investment, they can get it. Okay. And I think the future, I hope the future is everybody gets connected easily and you can put an idea forward and foster it and grow it, build a community around it, and then turn it into an experience.
Okay, let's go to Twitter for your question from the fans. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, follow me on Twitter at GameOverGreggy, which Craig Baradon, my editor, puts up every week, it turns out. I tell you who's on the show, you tweet a question. Of course, I got a million questions, want to know all about, you know, leaks and your next project and when's it coming out and stuff. What do you want to say? What's your catch-all answer for that?
For my next project?
Yeah.
It's going to be the biggest game of all time. Everyone's going to play it. No one will play any games anymore after it comes out.
Wow. Well, there you go. Yeah. All right, when's it coming out?
Low bar. Soon.
Okay. Well, all right. Okay. We're going to go to at Noah Bench here. Noah asks, has the vision for Bungie changed? What kinds of experiences does the studio want to create going forward?
I think overall the vision for Bungie is still what it's always been. We've always been focused on building communities, building games that connect people, building games we love, and hoping that our fans want to play them. Money's always nice, but we need just enough to pay the bills and to be happy with what we build. And okay. So
now that you know you're Xbox exclusive for so long, mm-hmm. now you're talking about you know whatever may happen on your next game project that'll be the biggest thing in the world. You can yep. go multi-platform. Do you when you think about it, is there a wall between you and iOS and consoles and all this stuff, or is it just that Bungie is making games?
Yeah, and we're just making games. Okay. I mean, I think I said early on to the press when we announced we were leaving Microsoft that. You know, our goal was to build great entertainment, and if you build a great piece of entertainment, you want as many people as possible to experience it, to play it. And so, you know, we'll take our game to whatever platform's the right platform for it, and wherever we can engage with an audience in the right way.
All right, great. Harold, thank you so much for
yep,
coming by.
Thanks.
Look for Bungie's next game to be the biggest thing in the history of the world on some platform on Sunday. That's it for this week. If you enjoyed the show, please subscribe and leave a comment. And please check out our other episodes and sketches. I'll be online for the first hour this video is up responding to comments. So hey, stop on by and have a chat. Thank you to Jeremiah Slaczka, Harold Ryan, Mike Drucker, Brian Altano, and the audience. If you want to be in that audience, go.ign.com/upatnoon for details. Come to the show, there's a chance you could win some free stuff. We'll be back next Friday at noon, but until then, nope, next Monday at noon. When's this show go live? I don't know. I'm very tired. I'm going back to bed.